Hello and welcome to Monday's edition of Twa Teams One Street from the Courier. I'm not Dan Duffy, I'm Sean Hamilton. Dan is away again. Man of leisure these days. A bit like yourself, Graeme.
Yeah, he's here. He's been a man of leisure for the last 14 years. Let's be honest.
Yes, he's been living the dream.
We used to sit in the office. I used to wonder where he went all week. That's the honest answer to that one. So nothing has changed in that respect.
Yeah, he showed me the way. Let's put it that way. I think we'll start with Dundee United this week. But obviously, joining us for their expertise is Alan Temple, who was at Fir Park on Friday night. We've got Graeme Finnan, the Bear, with us as well, and Jim Spence also. So let's get stuck into Dundee United, first of all. 2-1. Frustrating stuff from a Dundee United perspective, I would suggest, given the timing and the nature of Motherwell's two goals, specifically coming so late at the end of the first half and indeed at the end of the second half from a set piece as well. I mean, talk about, you know, stating the obvious, but that was probably the vibe after the game from likes of Jim Goodwin at Allen.
Yeah, I mean, Jim Goodwin basically said it was as down as he's felt after a game for a very, very long time, which, considering obviously a very long time is quite a unspecific period of time, but, you know, he was relegated not long ago, so it kind of underlines just how painful this particular defeat must have been. And, you know, it was a strange old game, because I certainly wouldn't have been thinking that it was going to be a thrilling finale as that first half went on, because it was a very ordinary game of football, which I actually thought Dundee United just about shaded. I thought they had decent control in the middle of the park. I thought Ross Docherty makes a hell of a difference in there, and they were just about getting an overload in there with Babinski floating in, and you were knocking about the ball about nicely, but still not creating enough. And that is an ongoing thing that needs to be remedied. And if you're not going to create enough chances, the last thing you can do is give away kind of sloppy, you know, slightly panicked goals. And that's what happened in the stroke of halftime. Whereas, you know, United seemed reluctant to take a pop up goal, seemed reluctant to just, you know, roll the dice, if you like. Yeah. Motherwell did. You know, Lennon Miller takes a dig at goal, relatively hopeful. It's parried, panic stations. Zach Robinson with an absolutely wonderful finish. So that's, you know, that underlined maybe that, you know, if you just have the audacity to actually just have a dig, spin and hit, then good things can come from that. But the second half was a totally different game, far more open, and at the time the equaliser came, I thought it was really, really deserved. United went 2 up top, and again, creates more questions than it does give answers, to be perfectly honest, in terms of the fact that they did look so much more threatening with 2 up front. They looked so much more threatening with Louis Moult and the team. So it bodes the question, does that need to be the way we move forward from the start? Because United haven't scored a first half goal in quite a while now, and they tend to look better once Jim Goodwin alters his strategies. So that certainly will give him a lot of food for thought. And I mean, I don't know what you can say about the last minute challenge. It's a rush of blood to the head, and I think it's a rush of blood to the head that has come about because of the fact that United maybe lost the run of themselves a wee bit just in those closing stages, you know, having got that equaliser and having been in the ascendancy with so many attacking players on the pitch. I think they just thought, this is here for us, keep going, keep pushing. And that's all fine and well, but it's a lot easier to push for a goal when there's only one team actually pushing. You know, Motherwell had dropped back, Motherwell were defending, Motherwell just wanted to not concede a goal. The moment United equalise, Motherwell's perspective changes also, and you needed to be more aware of that. You needed to be more aware of the danger Motherwell were going to. And I mean, I tweeted as much after that Motherwell equaliser that I thought there was another goal in it. I thought it was going to be a hairy finale, because United had too many attacking players on the pitch. They were going too gung-ho. And if they didn't alter that, if they didn't manage the game, there was going to be another goal in the kind of preceding 10 minutes. And it proved to be a Motherwell goal.
Yeah. I mean, Jim, the challenge for the penalty, I don't want to labour it too much because, you know, as a young player, I think he held his hands up, didn't he, after the game and basically apologised for it, pretty much. It was a silly challenge, a naive one. When you watch it back, you're like, oh, no, don't. and you get suckered right in. It was naivety, wasn't it?
I've watched it back again about three times before I came on. On here to do the podcast, Sean, and it is that's the word, naivety. He almost slides in slow motion, you know. I'm not entirely sure what he intends to achieve by sliding in. I mean, in a situation like that, I think all you want to really do is block, is put your body between yourself and any potential, you know, low cross that's coming, because he's close, he's very close to the player. So it is, and he puts his hand up and all the rest of it, but the damage is done by that. If I'm being slightly picky, I actually thought that Motherwell's first goal from Robinson, that could, you know, It was a short end, wasn't it? It was clear that went to the right for Robinson. I thought he maybe could have been closed in a wee bit quicker. Was it Graeme, I think, who was marking him at the time? But that, you know, that's one of these things. I mean, the game is played in the instant, in the moment, you know. But Stevenson's rashness in the tackle, which ultimately cost United when, you know, when they were trying to kind of see the game out, I suppose, it's just one of these things. It's a kind of thing that a young boy does. He's, you know, I mean, he is a young, very inexperienced player at that level. You know, there's whether it's a rush of blood to the head, whether it's kind of panic stations, it really doesn't matter. He will only learn from that experience. Unfortunately, the learning curve for United is that they're at the cup. And that's pretty costly, both in terms of finance and prestige as well. But it's one experience that hopefully will stand them in better stead into the future. But it was a very naive one. Had it been an older player doing it, I think you'd have maybe been more critical. But he's a youngish player, and he's fairly new. Well, he's very new to playing at that level of football and that level of intensity. So in that respect, you know, you tend to be in more forgiving mode.
Yeah, being out the cup, Graeme, and this is something that we will touch on when we speak about Dundee as well, but United, first of all, you saw what it meant to the support just via the numbers that they took through to Fir Park on Friday. It was a fantastic Dundee United support, and you saw what the equaliser meant to them with the celebration. It was a wild one. And being out of the cup at this stage, it's a painful one, isn't it? Because, I mean, United have had their ups and downs over the last few years, and I think cup progressions, it's not the most important thing for Dundee United this season, but it's one of those things that would be a nice wee signifier of being on the right track again, wouldn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I felt for them because they travelled in big, big numbers for a Friday night game that was screened on the TV. You know, not everybody had the opportunity to see it, but I think, you know, especially the way the game has gone, United in the ascendancy after scoring. I have to confess, I did just see highlights of the game, so my perspective might be slightly different. But what I saw was, a game of very few chances initially. Motherwell get the goal, and United realise unless they get a goal, they are going out of that competition. And they do step up the ante, and they get their goal. And when you get your goal 10 minutes from time, you know, you do feel that you are the team that are in the ascendancy and should go on and win the game. But I think you've got to credit Motherwell. I mean, what I saw certainly in the highlights was it wasn't that. Motherwell certainly started to create a bit more themselves after United had equalised. And then it was going to, it's unfortunate, it boils down to an error of judgment from Stevenson. It reminded me a wee bit, Jim, if you've watched the Scotland game against Poland, the Grant Hanley one where the player's going wide of the goal and you're going, don't tackle.
Don't tackle.
He's not scoring from there. Don't go there, and boom. And Grant Hanley's an experienced player, I've got to say, for making that sort of challenge. But the Lucas Stevenson one, you could probably, you know, be a bit, kind to him by saying he is a young lad and he will learn from that. But that doesn't help the 2,000 Dundee United fans who I'd imagine it felt like a punch below the belt at that point in time. And I think it feels worse because it was a genuine opportunity. The way United have started the season to continue that sort of momentum and you know, having Hamden in the back pocket and going there would have been terrific. And there's not to be forgotten about the financial, you know, windfall they would have received for getting to Hamden isn't insignificant, you know. So all in all, it must have been a sore bus journey back from Fir Park.
Particularly for those who'd had their carryouts nicked by the police as well.
Well, yeah, somebody said that to me, so I made sure mine was well hidden going through Ibrox on Saturday.
I saw Ali Heather wasn't having a blast on X about that, you know. Mm-hmm. He did get some. He got his keys back, but no, his carryout.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Right, I mean, Alan, you touched on the fact that United... One thing that Jim Goodwin does have in his arsenal is seems to be an ability to make a change during the game that has a positive impact for Dundee United. The flip side of that is, if you're having to make that change, the question becomes, is there an issue with the way you're starting the match then? I mean, are there question marks building amongst United fans about that, perhaps, about his starting 11 picks?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's probably the conversation of the day, I would say, among the United fans at the moment, is how to take what is, certain good aspects of what at the start of the season. Because I think it is important that you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater on this one. That, you know, there's a relatively strong spine there. There's players that are playing well. However, it's not quite clicking in the final third. They're not quite clicking enough, creating enough clear chances. And there's no getting away from the fact that as games progress and Jim Goodwin, you know, alters things, quite often maybe goes three in the middle, goes two up top, they then start to look more threatening. Now, the big question, and without want to get too kind of tactical about this stuff, is, you know, it can sometimes be a little bit easier for these changes to be impactful when you're coming into a broken game, when the game has already kind of found its pattern You know, the other team is pushing for something and you're pushing for something. It's a completely different objective to when a game's starting and you're trying to wrestle control of that game. And Jim Goodwin might be sitting there thinking, well, I mean, we were roughly in control of that game against Motherwell. Would we have been in control of that game if we'd gone with an orthodox two up front? Or would we have been, you know, overloaded in certain areas? So that's all the sort of exceptionally complex things that the managers get paid lots of money to countenance and will ultimately keep or lose their jobs from. So, but I would say, in terms of things that I think do need to happen, I think Louis Moult needs to start the next game, because I think he could reasonably say, you know, you talk about earning your chance, you talk about working hard and trying to grab a jersey. He could reasonably be in, you know, Jim's office this week saying, I don't know what else you want from me if that's not going to earn me a start. Because even in the one up front role that Jort van der Sand's been asked to do, I don't think Louis Moult is incapable of doing a lot of the things that Jort van der Sand does. Louis works hard and links up well and does a lot of that good stuff. However, he also does carry a goal threat. I'm not sure there's another, I mean, maybe David Babunski, another player who could technically score that goal that Louis Moult scored at Fir Park.
Yeah.
He is the most instinctive finisher that Dundee United have got, and certainly among their strikers. And I just think if you want to add a goal threat, we can complicate things. We can talk about shapes. We can talk about what needs to change here and there. I think the first thing I would be changing, with no disrespect to Jort van der Sand at all, because he's not had many chances to miss, is I would be bringing in Louis Moult, because I think you can potentially be a more creative team by just inserting a striker whose first instinct is always, can I get a shot away? Can I do something that will result in a goal? Which I don't think has always seems to be Jort van der Sand's first instinct, to be perfectly honest. So I, in terms of shape, I would probably go two up top. I'm not 100% sure that in a 3-5-2, I'm not entirely sure Jim Goodwin will do that. But what I would certainly think that even Jim Goodwin might veer towards is giving Louis Moult that start that he's been so desperate for, because I don't know what more he can really do to earn that, to be honest.
Yeah, I know that from listening to last Thursday's edition of Twa Teams, one of the talking points was players who choose not to celebrate against our former sides when they scored. Louis Moult ticked that box for us on Friday night when he scored for United. He did not celebrate. He held his hands out in almost apology, if you like. I mean, what do we make of that, Jim? It's got a bit of a mixed reaction. There's some support from United fans for him. There's some maybe a bit more critical of it. I mean, where do you stand on this, Sean, celebrating thing?
I took a slightly different kind of view of it. I kind of thought that looking at Moult, that there was an element, and I'm playing amateur psychologist here trying to read into body language. I kind of had the impression that Moult was saying, what more do you want me to do to get a starting berth in this team?
Right.
That was the impression I got. Right. I thought he looked like a man, I thought, quite deeply disappointed the fact that he'd had to come on. I mean, and Alan's absolutely spot on. Of that squad, instinctively, by his nature, Moult is the supreme goal scorer. That's what he does. Give him a chance and he will at least get it on target, you know? I mean, you know, the goal he took was a thing of beauty. I mean, he hardly had any looking room at the ball. It dropped and he was on it in a flash. I mean, there was a marker very, very close by him, but he got it away and he got it away with accuracy and power. And it may well be that there are different elements. It may well be that he didn't want to celebrate against his old side. I'm not a big fan of that. You're a professional football player. You're now playing for a team that pay your wages. Your duty is to show that you enjoy the goal and you think it's something worth celebrating.
Your duty is to get it right up.
Yeah, well, exactly. That's right. You know, you've moved on. But I thought there was more, or certainly an element of Moult that was saying, there you are, gaffer. What do you want me to do here? You know, there's what I'm capable of, you know. And I think that, I mean, I think it's intriguing. I mean, now and again, I have a look at kind of fans' websites. I mean, just to get a kind of a wee feel. And I was having a look at, you know, some United stuff last night. And there is still a negativity from some fans about Jim Goodwin. Many feel that he's a bit overly cautious, overly negative as a manager. But he's a manager. And he has to, you know, put the team out and set the team up as he sees fit, because he's working with the guys in training all week, you know, and he sees what they're capable of, and he has styles and patterns of play that he wants players to adhere to. But I think he now is faced with a dilemma, and I think he's actually been potentially faced with it for a few weeks. Does he go two up top? Because I would give that a bang. I mean, I think the problem he's got with Vander Sands. I remember having a wee chat with Freddie Vanderhoorn, his agent, when he came across. He said, "I hope Jod can do what he's capable of." Now, in terms of work rate, you cannot fault him. His work rate is phenomenal. He puts a huge shift in the parlance. He's not often close enough to goal to get away, you know, get the kind of chances to take the opportunities, the kind of chance that fell to Moult. And that seems to be because of the role he's playing. I mean, very often, he's not so much playing as a kind of, you know, a striker, as almost like a forward-lying midfielder. And he's expected to bring it down, hold it up and lay it off. Well, you know, unless you've got a very quick and supple midfield, kind of laying it off to himself, you know. I'd be really tempted to go to have a bang with two up front. That obviously means the team has to be rejigged, and then what you're looking for is ammunition. Who will provide the ammunition to the two up front? Failing that, if he's going to go with one up front, I think Alan's right. I think Moult undoubtedly has proven with the goal that if there's to be one man up front on Saturday, it should be him, because I think he's a more natural goal scorer, and at the moment that's what United need.
Certainly looks that way. And just finally, Bear, I mean, United, until they return to Tannadice, they've another two games away from home, so a couple of weeks yet until they're back home. Tricky ones, away to Kilmarnock and then away to St Mirren. I mean, Alan's touched on the fact that in terms of providing for strikers, there are players there who are capable of doing that for United, you know, like Trapanovsky and Babunski and what have you. Mm-hmm. Do you think a secondary striker is perhaps the way forward for them?
It could be. I think it's worth a bash. That's whether Jim Goodwin thinks it's worth a bash. You know, that's what it'll boil down to. And as I think I said on last week's podcast, you know, the points they've gained this season have been from a more defensive setup. That's what they've got the majority of their 8 points this season. They managed to pick teams off on the counter attack and get goals and keep it really tight at the back. But you know, you talk about Moult, and I thought he did well for his goal. But also thought Glenn Middleton showed he's still got something to offer. And Glenn Middleton hasn't had a look in at all, Alan, really, this season. So I think he can play a big role. Jim's talking about for strikers to score, they need service. Glenn Middleton does what it says on the tin. He goes down, he's got a wee trick in his locker. He'll get past defenders, but he gets balls in the box. That's what I like about Glenn Middleton. You know, he gets balls in and says, go and do something with that. And that's certainly an interesting one for the weekend. Has Glenn Middleton maybe done enough to get himself into the team?
I think it would require a kind of big rejig in terms of a starting lineup that would involve Glenn Middleton, just due to the fact that he would either require dropping Will Ferry, which won't happen, or playing with a left winger, which probably won't happen either. But I think it's brilliant that Bear points that out, because he's probably the one guy that I didn't shine enough of a light on in the post-match stuff, because obviously Dalby's the man that chests it down to Louis Moult, and you know, they're the subs that made the most visible impact. But Glenn was really good from the very first moment he touched the ball. He beat a man and clipped a brilliant ball in, which Dalby heads into the arms of the goalkeeper. There was a moment of creativity that had been lacking for a kind of to that point. So not only was it a really good cameo, but it speaks really, really well to Glenn's professionalism and work rate, and just clearly keeping himself sharp, because this is a player that's not started the game in a very, very long time. He's not played a minute of Premiership football. So for him to come on and have not only the ability to do what he did, but also the professionalism, I think, speaks really well to him. And I think, you know, although he'd love to be starting games, I think first step is make yourself a more principal first substitute when Jim Goodwin's thinking, how do I change games? And I think he'll have done that, so that when Jim's next looking to his bench for somebody that can change a match, I think Glenn's shown that he deserves to be right in that conversation.
Yep, but a player with a point to prove, perhaps that's usually a good motivation for a guy like that. Let's see if we have any more of a sense of which way Jim Goodwin's going to go by the time Thursday's edition comes around. Chaps, thank you for your expertise, and we'll see you again on Thursday.